created this.
Annie und Damo Radler.
Jeder ist kreativ.
Todos somos creativos.
Everyone is creative.
Une vie créative exige bravoure et action.
Ali Heck, cohort job.
We are here to support you.
Se celebrón, a l'autour de Tina.
E invitarte a hacer las cosas que amas.
No, pentru toate jam, bovarden.
We believe in giving a damn.
我们相信面对面的互动.
In aprender de los demás.
In hugs and high fives.
Unimos pessoas que são movidas por paixão e propósito.
Gens qui s'inspirent mutuellement.
In Nachbarschaften und Städten auf der ganzen Welt werden.
Todos son bienvenidos.
Alla è welcome.
Quante lune, este bienvenido.
我们欢迎每个人.
Tout le monde est le bienvenu.
Everyone is welcome.
Yeah, you see, I always get goosebumps when I see this because it's such a lovely video. Wait, I need to close this that I can see you. It's such a great video. And yeah, I always have a little bit tears in my eyes because that's why we do it, because of the community. And today I want to travel with you to Russia and introduce you to my beloved Evgenia from WeWork. So we work together at WeWork. She's host at WeWork and I'm a member. So she always takes good care of me. And today she will tell us a little bit about her story. Hi.
Yeah, hi. First of all, Nanina, thank you so much for actually giving me a chance to talk about my country and about my story. I think it's very exciting and I feel that it's like a lot of responsibility as well, because for so many people, Russia is still a very controversial country with really like confusing image right now. So I feel very like, you know, honored in a way. And I'm a big fan of Creative Mornings. I attended actually a few of them back in Moscow, and we were planning to organize one in Cologne at WeWork actually. And I really hope that soon we're going to be able to do that. Thank you so much for finding the time to actually join. Sorry.
It was planned in July, right? At WeWork, Cologne, but I'm pretty sure there will be a point where we can do it.
Yes, we will make it happen. So yeah, I was actually born and raised in Moscow. I lived there for 23 years of my life and I moved to Germany 3 years ago. And yeah, it was a big adjustment after this huge and vibrant megapolis, which Moscow is, moving to Cologne, which is relatively small, especially if you compare it to Moscow. But yeah, I think that's it's really interesting to dive into a little bit in the, like, you know, not obvious topics of living in Russia, but some, like, you know, social agenda and, like, in general, you know, travel a little bit and discover some topics that are not that obvious. And sometimes I interpret it a little bit differently via media outlets. And yeah, so short disclaimer, I'm going to be talking about my experience and my point of view, and it might be completely different for some other people, and that's completely fine. But yeah, I'm not forcing anyone to think like I do. It's like completely my personal experience and my, you know, the way I feel. I prepared a small visual tour for you, so you can actually not just stare at me, but have a look a little bit more at Moscow and at some, like, you know, people who actually formed this country and the story of this country. I'm gonna share my screen.
Yeah, and the picture's amazing. So I saw the presentation in the afternoon and I wanted to go straight to the airport and discover the landscape of Russia.
Yeah, I hope that at the end of this talk, most of you will like consider visiting Russia, at least Moscow for sure, because I unfortunately didn't have a chance to travel that much around Russia, but I can vouch for Moscow. It's really the place to be. Yeah, so here actually a few pictures from my own Instagram, and you can see some like touristy pictures like Red Square, but also like some not that obvious attractions, so like some obvious, you know, shots. For example, in the left bottom corner, this is the view of from my grandparents' apartment, and you can see that Moscow is really like heavily built. It can come across as a little bit too gray and a little bit like too heavy, because you have these like huge block houses everywhere. But for us, it's just like something normal. This is where we grew up. And when I was looking for an apartment in Cologne, my partner and I were actually visited a few of like houses like more than five stories up. And for him, it was something that he can't imagine living in. And for me, it was just like, I didn't understand what was the issue there. And yeah, Moscow is huge. It has really wide pedestrian crosses, wide, like, you know, streets for cars. And in general, it's big. So like when you're there, you can really feel that the city is so big and it keeps growing. So they constantly do some kind of works to improve the city center situation, especially after the last few events, like worldwide events that we held, like World Cup 2 years ago. Was it 2 years? I think it was 2 years ago. So it's constantly improving. And every time when I visit now, I sometimes don't even recognize some places because they change so much. But yeah, like the whole spirit you can feel in Moscow, that it's very, very fast. Everything is fast there. People are walking fast. Cars are driving fast. Trains are coming really fast. So it's really like, you know, the cities that is constantly in this, like, you know, fast moving pace. And for me, one of my personal treasures of Moscow is actually Moscow Metro. On the right, you can see pictures of like, that's actually train stations. This is where you get every morning and evening to catch a train to like university, home, work, whatever. It's really a masterpiece and it's really deep in the ground. So you need like around 5 minutes on the escalator to get down there, but it's totally worth it. And especially now they made it very like friendly for foreign guests. All stations are translated into English. They're announced into English. So it's like really difficult to get lost there. And I believe that it's like, we are really spoiled. People from Moscow, like who live in Moscow, are very spoiled. By this system, because when I moved to Cologne, I was like, okay, is that it? That's really, how do you understand where I need to go? It's like so unclear, so confusing. And I think it's the same, like even for London, New York, it's very big developed rail stations, but still it's very confusing. And in Moscow, it's very certain in a way. You have like the circle, the brown one, and you can basically get anywhere you want. They actually 2 years ago, or 3 years ago, they opened the second circle. It's like in the orange around. And yeah, it's like, it shows how much Moscow is growing. It's like they're constantly building the stations, they're expanding it, and it seems sometimes that Moscow doesn't have an end. I always have a feeling that soon it's gonna like expand even more. Yeah, but obviously living in a city like this brings a lot of people there and a lot of traffic, and sometimes you have to squeeze yourself in the morning in the train, or like, you know, you can stay 2 hours after work in the traffic jam. So it's all like, you know, the downside of living there. And yeah, sometimes you can get overwhelmed by the amount of people, but I think you get used to that. And I miss it sometimes when it's like not crowded enough. I feel like, okay, that's a bit empty, that's a bit weird. I mean, putting aside the self-isolation and COVID-19 crisis right now, but just like, you know, how it usually is. And I also have to say that although quality of life in Russia and in Moscow is lower than in Germany, obviously, the comfort of life, I should say that it's way, way higher in Moscow. So everything is open 24/7. For me, it was really a cultural shock when I couldn't go to the supermarket in Germany on Sunday. It was just like something outrageous. How come is it closed?
I think that we need to explain to all our people outside of Germany. So in Germany, Sunday is really everything shut down. So we had a Scottish intern in February, and he wanted also to do his grocery shopping on Sunday. And he asked me, why is everything closed here? So that's just a side information for everyone outside of Germany.
Yeah, true. I got used to German reality that I forget that the rest of the world might be functioning in a little bit more Moscow-like schedule. But yeah, you can also get anything you want delivered to your door within the few hours. I don't know, like Uber rides and some kind of like, you know, services. They're way more affordable in Moscow than in Germany. Obviously, if you compare with the salary level, then it's not going to be that cheaper. But when I come home, I like bring my German salary, and then it's like, whoa, it's really affordable. And that's the thing, that if you have money, you can live really comfortable life in Moscow. You can get anything you want, you can get it really fast. And yeah, I miss sometimes this, like, you know, instant with which you can get things, because in Germany you have to get used to the fact that you have to wait for some things, and Moscow doesn't wait. Like, people don't wait for anyone. They are really fast. And I was lucky enough to be born in Moscow. Thank you, my parents, for that. But I know that many people like are coming to Moscow to like how to make it happen, how to make it work. And they find jobs, and sometimes it can get really like intense. I remember, I mean, it depends on the industry, of course, but I worked in an agency before, and working 12 hours a day, it was completely normal. And if you left the office before 8, people will look at, we're looking at you a bit weirdly, like, what, you don't have anything to do? So you have this, like, you know, tendency of showing that you're super busy and that you have so much to do. That's kind of like, you know, part of culture of being in Moscow, that you constantly have to be busy and you have to show people that you're busy. Yeah, at least it was in the industries where I work. I'm pretty sure that in some, and I hope that, like, you know, this work-life balance is improving right now and people are not, like, you know, overdoing it and getting burnout at 25. But yeah, that's a little bit the case. And also interesting for me, it was also, like, you know, confusing, because when you are originally from Moscow, you live with your parents, because real estate market is very, like, intense. It's very tough to find an apartment in Moscow. It's going to cost a lot of money, and you have absolutely no pressure to rent an apartment at the age of 18, like, to move out from your parents, because for most of, like, people, at least in my environment, at least in my, like, you know, among my friends, everyone was living with their parents till they find a partner with whom they can actually rent an apartment. So it's really unusual to rent a house or an apartment with your friends, unless you're coming from another region just to study and to work here. So I was going to, like, Moscow school, so most of my friends were from Moscow. And yeah, all of them, they lived, even now, like, getting closer to 30, they're still living with their parents simply because they didn't meet this right person with whom they can move in and, like, you know, share rent and share an apartment. But yeah, many of them are living just like with their parents till they're 30 or even longer, because there is no pressure to find an apartment, and it's really uncommon to do that. And I find it very interesting, because in Germany, everyone is renting an apartment at the age of 18. They're sharing the flat with a few roommates, and that's, like, completely normal. That's kind of what's expected of you to do. And in Moscow, it's completely different. And yeah, I think it kind of influences the way, what kind of separation process you have within the family. And obviously, if you're living with your parents till you're 30, it's not a healthy separation. You know, your parents are still, like, interfering a lot with your personal life, with your decisions. So I think it's also, like, you know, an interesting side of it. And yeah, till I moved to Germany, I was living with my mom, and there was not even a thought in my head that I would be renting an apartment, because my salary, I would have to give, like, you know, 2/3 of my salary to rent at least a room. And it was just like, why would I do that when I have a place here? So it's like, you know, the mentality that many people share who are living in Moscow as their parents.
Can you maybe tell us why you moved to Germany?
Yeah, I moved because of love.
You speak perfect German, so you learned German in school?
No, I actually learned German when I moved to Germany. I was forced to do that.
Because yeah. You're fluent in German, and it's a quite tough language.
Yeah, no, I fell in love with an exchange student who decided he wants to do something exotic and spend his semester abroad in Moscow, for what I'm really grateful. And yeah, he came to my university and we fell in love. And after 3 years of long distance, flying back and forth, we decided to actually start living together. And I moved to Germany, because moving to Moscow, although he really wanted to, it was, like, you know, not really logical from many perspectives. It's a difficult city to get settled in, especially if you don't speak the language, I have a feeling.
Yeah, but that's the perfect reason to move to another country. We had that last week with Ben, who moved to Dubai, also a German guy, also because of love, and they celebrated exactly on that day their first anniversary. Wedding anniversary. So, yeah.
But I have feeling that most of the people who are moving to Cologne are doing that because of love. It's like really the place for Cologne. No one is moving there just because I've always dreamed of living in Cologne. No, everyone is moving because their partner is there. Yeah, and actually that's a perfect intro to my next slide is traveling. And that's what many many of European friends and colleagues don't understand and don't really see that as an issue, but Russian passport is a really weak one. And we need a visa to get almost everywhere. And it was really tough to get all the documents that I needed while moving to Germany. And every time when you travel, you have to apply for Schengen visa, but it depends from which country you got the Schengen visa. For example, if you got it from Spain, you can't enter in Germany, or if you do that, they might not let you in. So it's always a lot of tension to do that. And yeah, sometimes, like, you know, you get used to it, obviously. It's like your reality, you know, you're right. You have to apply for a visa. You know what kind of documents you need together, but still it's always, you have to prove why you want to come back, why you don't want to stay in this country. And at least I had a feeling that it was always kind of like, you know, I felt a little bit unwelcome while traveling when people saw my passport. And it's the thing, like, you can't control with which passport you are born. You can't control in which country you're born. So it's really weird that some people are judged just by this, because it's just like, I don't know, it seems so wrong and unfair. And I really hope that at some point in the future, we're going to have like this, you know, global society where we can travel wherever we want without any restrictions. But for now, yeah, for Russian citizenship, it can be citizens, it can be a bit more challenging to travel somewhere abroad, because you have to go through the interview process, submit many documents, pay fees, which are not affordable sometimes, right? So German Schengen visa costs around 100 euros, I think, US or UK visa around 300 euros. So it's like a lot of money to pay extra to add to your travel budget sometimes. And actually, every time when we travel here with my partner, and we in the car, we go to the Netherlands or to Belgium, every time when we cross this border, which is basically nothing in Europe, I have a small blast and I'm like, oh my God, we just crossed the border. No one stopped us. We're in another country. So for me, it's still, after 3 years, it's like a small, you know, like, ooh, so what is happening? This is so exciting. So yeah, let's hope that one day we're going to believe in the world where traveling is really open to everyone. But for now, unfortunately, it's not the case.
But you also have a personal decision to make, which passport you want to have in the future, right?
Yeah, so it's actually from Germany. It's the regulation that if you apply for German citizenship, you have to give up your passport. And then when I have to visit my family and friends in Russia, I'll have to actually apply for a visa. So it's going to work the other way around. And it makes me feel a bit weird, because it's like you got kind of a guest in the country where you grew up. So I'm not sure if I'm going to do that yet, but I'm considering, yeah.
Yeah, and even where your parents are living, right? So for me, it's a strange feeling to know that you have to apply for a visa just to see your parents.
Yeah, it's definitely, it's like a very tricky situation, and something that you don't think of when you move to another country, that at some point you'll have to, you know, give up your passport. I don't see it as giving up part of your identity, because no one can take your identity away from you. It's something inside. It's not a piece of paper that you carry around. But still, it's like a big step, you know, to take the regulations from another country and, like, you know, be a guest in your own. So it's really weird. A friend of mine, she actually went through the process of giving up her Colombian citizenship to get a German one. And she said that it was pretty emotional for her as well.
Yeah, I can definitely feel that.
Yeah, but obviously living in Russia also means that first thing that people say when you introduce yourself and say where you come from, it's like association with Mr. Putin. It's an iconic person, politician in the history, and I should be like straight right away. I have pretty radical views on his leading style and in general his position. And to demonstrate why, like on the right, I took screenshots from one of the media outlets. It's called Medusa. They're very, like, you know, radical as well. And they're trying to be a bit more, you know, open and straightforward. They actually registered not in Russia, but in Riga. That's why they allow, they can be, like, you know, that's straightforward. And they launched last year, I think, a calculator where you can enter your date of birth. And it's going to show you what kind of, what percentage of your life you spent with Putin as a president. I was born on April 7th, 1994, and 80% of my life happened with Putin as a president. And when you think about it, it's insane, because, like, in Russian constitution, it's written that we are a democratic state. what kind of democracy are we talking about when we can't, like, the same guy is leading the country and there is no way for him to stop?
Yeah, and changing the law every time. So I just saw in the chat, I say just one word, Trump. So in America, there's one point where they can't be the leader again, but I think in Russia, there is no way to get rid of Putin, right?
Exactly. Like, I think with Trump, like, at least in America, and please correct me if I'm wrong, but you have some regulations that, okay, he can be elected twice, but then he has to go. He can't stay for the third time, no matter what he's doing. But with Putin, so he was president twice, 4 years each, then he took a break, then he became a president again, then he changed the constitution, so he increased his presidential term from 4 to 6 years, and now, after he's been president for like really enormous amount of time, now he's looking into rebooting his presidential term and putting all the years before to zero, so he in 2024 he can apply, he can be elected again for another 12 years. So it's really, for me, it's something that I don't understand, because I see that the progress has to happen with different leaders. And in Russia, it's not the case. We have the same person with the same, you know, like, group of people whom he calls close to him. And I don't have a feeling, I'm not really into deep into politics, but from like the perspective, you know, what I see, that these people, they're not interested in the country, they're not interested in doing something good for the country, they're just interested in like stealing money from the government budget, and it's kind of like, you know, encouraged from Putin's side, from really very top, and yeah, people are just not really caring about other ones, because you have really, really poor regions in Russia, and nobody takes care of them, and yeah. It just, I don't know, it's very rotten. It's very, I don't know, very corrupt. And that part of the reason why many people want to leave Russia, simply because they know that one day someone can come to you and you'll have to pay a bribe, or someone's going to destroy you just because they didn't like you. And it doesn't make you feel secure. You don't really believe in the government. You think that they're against you, and there is nothing you can do. But obviously people are trying now to show their position, they're trying to, like, you know, express their concern. For example, we have Navalny, he's one of the opposition's leaders, and in 2019 he was trying to participate in the presidential election as well. Ended up on the picture left bottom, someone spilled Zelenka, this is basically iodium, but like in green, it's something that you use on your wounds, but it's really concentrated acid. Someone spilled it in his face and his eye got damaged and he had to get surgery. There was like even concern that he's going to lose his vision. And it was basically like a warning to him, don't get into that. He also has a YouTube channel, was like, yeah, 3.6 million subscribers. All his videos are in Russian, but he has English subtitles there. And basically, he's doing all kind of videos about the real estate that all these, like, you know, government people have abroad, or like what kind of budgets they're stealing. And he's trying to really to dig into that. It's some stories are really mind blowing. You can't believe that it's really happening and that it's like legal. You know, no one is being sued for that, because it's really obvious. But on the other hand, it's a very controversial persona as well, because Putin is like, really, he keeps everything under control in terms of that no one is allowed to express their position that loudly. But this guy has been around for many years and he's like doing, yeah, this public, you know, public investigations. And the question is here, there are some conspiracy theories that he is actually powered by Putin or like by Kremlin themselves to make sure that, like, in Russia you have some kind of opposition. I don't know. I don't know what to believe. I choose to believe him simply because it's better to believe in something rather than like think that everything is rotten, corrupt, and it's like, you know, very strategically built into a huge machine that you can't get away of. But yeah, this is definitely a person who comes to mind when we talk about opposition and all this political tension in the country. And I think from the year 2016, in Moscow especially, it was really tense. We started having regular protests and regular gatherings. Most of them are not even approved by the government, so people are still gathering to go outside with the posters, with the banners to express their civil position. And I think it's a very good demonstration how to that people like they had enough. They really want to see something changed. And some of the protests, they were really brutal because the police, they were informed to basically capture anyone who was acting a little bit too, I don't know, active. But it ended up that they were just like gathering people who were doing nothing, just like, you know, some young girls or the guys with the Russian flags who were just like walking around trying to express their position in a really peaceful way. But yeah, it ended up to be really, really brutal. And I had a few friends who ended up spending the night in prison for that and got later charged with some administrative cases, like ridiculous. They had to pay 100 euros or something like this, but still, it's like, you know, it stays in your history. And yeah, I think it's gonna come even more with the upcoming elections and the upcoming changes in the constitution, because people are really getting really frustrated, especially young generation. People who were born in like 2020, they spend their whole life, who were born in 2000, it's like they're 20 years right now, and they spend their whole life with Putin, and they want to see something different, and they're pretty like, you know, energetic and radical, and they have access to other sources of information and other points of view rather than the state channels, the government channels. So they're getting really like, you know, upset. And I find it's good. It's very scary. It's like any revolution is scary, but I think it has to come at some point, because otherwise it's just like, you know, gonna end up like North Korea in a way, because it's really the same person with the same views who stays there and doesn't really want to change anything.
Yeah, also our first travel talk was with Jimmy, and we traveled to Lebanon, and he also told us that the young generation is now fighting for their future, and they want to have a change because, yeah, the whole government is just corrupt and looking for money and their personal benefits, but not for, yeah, for the people. So, yeah.
Yeah, that's the same case, really. I think, in a way, although Moscow is very European and progressive, it's still the same, you know, like old-fashioned people who think they can just like steal money from the government budget and, I don't know, like order to, well, not to kill someone, but you know what I mean, like I'm trying to put it in a politically correct way, which is a bit difficult. But also about the police, I experienced a weird situation a few days ago. I met a friend and we were like in a park in Cologne. We were sitting on a bench, keeping the social distancing. It was just the two of us, so we were doing nothing wrong. And then there was a police car circling around the block, and I got a proper panic attack. And I was like, okay, look down. Oh my God, let's go. I don't know where it came from, but in my head, it was like, okay, the policemen are not your friends. They're here to harm you, so like go and run. And it was a really weird feeling because I've never experienced any kind of like, you know, tension with the policeman. It's just the stories that I hear. It's just like, you know, things that I have in mind after growing up in Russia, that if you see a policeman, you better like walk around because he's not here to help you. He's not your friend. He'd rather like, you know, either gonna find some drugs in your bag because he has KPIs to fulfill and gonna ruin your life, or find the gun in your bag, which has actually happened to a friend of mine who now lives in Canada because he, after this situation, he was just like, he lost faith in his country, which is understandable. So yeah, and my friend who is actually Colombian, she was like, okay, chill, it's all good, like we're in Germany. But I had the second that I needed to come down, and it was out of nowhere. So it's really like, you know, the policeman, the image of the policeman in Russia is very, yeah, very, very difficult to proceed, I think. It's difficult to live in a place where you know that if something happens, police is not going to be there to help you. The people for whom you pay with your taxes, right, who are supposed to be there to protect you.
Yeah, and especially for me from Germany, it's really an unbelievable situation. And yeah, because in Germany, it's definitely different. And yeah, but I know that you have more examples, right?
Yeah, so it's a little bit more moving away from the police department, but talking a bit about feminist agenda, which is also a very sensitive topic, and it's like on top of the social tension pyramid right now in Russia. It's the case that happened last year, Khachaturian sisters. Basically, their father had some connection with the police and with the government, and he was keeping three of his daughters as prisoners at home. He was raping them, he was beating them, he was extremely mean to them, and they had absolutely no access. They were like proper victims. They couldn't talk to anyone. And yeah, at some point, I think the girls, they just like didn't see any other way, and they killed their father, which is a very, yeah, like, I don't know, I think it's the last desperate thing that you're going to do, because they're all young and they were just like, you know, on the edge. And the society divided into two categories. One of them, they were saying that actually they're monsters, they killed their own father, they should be in prison. And another one was actually saying, come on, they were victims of domestic violence for years. They couldn't go anywhere. They were trying to go to police. Police ignored them. And now the girls, I think the case is still ongoing, but they are not in prison. They are like getting some psychological help, because obviously living in one flat with the person who is doing that to you, who is your father, it's insane. It's like, I can't imagine what kind of, you know, psychological state they have right now. But yeah, many young girls went on this single protest holding a poster saying that it was self-defense, it's not a murder, that we support the sisters. And in general, you know, bringing this topic of domestic violence to the awareness of the society, because in Russia we don't have, we really don't have a law against domestic violence. It's thing like a rape in the marriage, it doesn't exist, you can't prove it. And so many stories when women whose husbands are beating them or like, you know, abusing them, they're calling the police, they're saying, okay, please help me. And the police says, okay, when you're going to get killed, then come to us. That's literally what they say. And yeah, I think now Russia in general, like in general, they were fighting for, you know, protecting the women who are actually in this position right now, because there is no systematic approach, there is no government regulations that's going to help you to get out of this. There are some non-profit but not government organizations for these women, but they can't help everyone. And there are so many of them, and many of them don't even know that they can say something, because, you know, the image of a Russian woman, like we even have a saying, a Russian woman can stop a running horse and walk into a burning house. So it's like you have a strong image of a Russian woman who's going to be walking in the field with like a baby whom she gave birth 2 hours ago or something like this. But on the other hand, you have like, you know, this patriarchy way of life where the man is the head of the family, no matter what are the man's intentions, capabilities and skills, he's still the head of the family. And like now the country is fighting against this paradigm, they're fighting against the statement to make sure that the equality is actually not just on paper, but it's actually happening in families as well, because everything starts from the family basically and move like further. So yeah. And another story that happened actually just last week, it's with one of the bloggers, influencers, TV hosts. Her name is Regina Todorenko. She is a Ukrainian one, but she's very famous in Russian. And while giving one of the interviews to Glamour magazine, she said something like, all the victims of domestic violence haven't asked themselves what did they do wrong to be beaten. And then like basically mental and insane to publicly accuse their husbands of harming them. And it's the first time in the history of Russia when people actually realize that that's an extremely unbelievably ignorant thing to say. And it's so harmful for her young followers in general, for all the women in the country. So she got a few of the awards revoked, her brand advertisement contracts got recalled. So she was really like, at the on the fire line of all this, like, you know, social tension. Obviously some people were defending her and saying that like, yeah, I would agree with this point of view, but others were saying, no, that's not okay. If someone beats you at home, it's not cool. It's not your fault. And she took a week to make a movie, 1.5 hour long movie about domestic violence that is called What Did You Do to Help? It's obviously a PR step for her to, like, you know, recover after this horrible situation and horrible statement that she made. But on the other hand, it's also very good that, like, you know, a public person like this with 8.5 million followers on Instagram now talks about domestic violence. So it shows again what kind of a sensitive topic it's right now. And yeah, I really hope that it's going to improve and that more and more women are going to be able to actually talk and walk away from the abusers. And yeah, that's, it's like, you know, baby steps for Russia into getting there. And now we're working, like the activists, female activists, they're working on implementing this domestic the law against domestic violence, but it's obviously going to take some time before it's in place. Yeah. I feel like I talk.
It's awful that we have such a country 2020, and especially it's so close to Europe, and I'm just shocked that not other countries support the women in Russia more. So, and even not just the women, more the whole population, I'm shocked about
this. It's intense. And you know, these topics, they're not really like on the public agenda out there. You talk about Putin, you talk about sanctions, but you don't really like dive into the country to see what kind of tension people who are living there experiencing. And you don't trust the government, okay, but like when you don't have any laws that are gonna protect you, how are you supposed to function in this place, you know? So it's very like, I think a tipping point for Russia right now to move forward to actually get some, I don't know, like adequate activists, adequate people at the government and in the government section and in general, you know, like support the groups of population of citizens that are being really depressed and demolished in a way. I think I have a feeling that I talked about some intense stuff right now, and
it's so that you also show us now the really, really beautiful side, because that because to be honest, I have seen so many countries in my life, but I've never been to Russia, but I was always a little bit worried about the political situation and about all the restrictions. So but now we are coming to the part where you all convince us to travel to
I wouldn't recommend moving to Russia as a female, at least now, or like, you know, as a political oppositionist, but it's still an amazing place to visit for sure. And I want to take you like on a short trip. So I don't know, I think it's like one of the wonders of the world for me is that something like this still exists in operations. It's Trans-Siberian Railway. It goes from Moscow to Vladivostok. And it's a train that takes you, basically like across the whole country. And it takes 143 hours to get to Vladivostok and 145 hours to get back. So basically 7 days on a train. I actually know some people who did it. It's not as romantic as it sounds. Please don't do that. Rather take, I don't know, a plane or like drive, because then you're going to be more flexible. And especially the ticket is not that expensive, not that cheap. And you end up in the really rough conditions. I mean, if you really want to connect with different racial social groups, then you can give it a try. But it's a pretty brutal adventure. But the point is that it gets you across the whole country, and it's really amazing that something that, like this is built and still operations. I wanted to show you a few of the images. As I mentioned before, unfortunately I didn't have a chance to actually travel around my country that much. I really hope I'm gonna change it, especially because I have a friend, I think she's actually on this call as well, hello Nastya, and she really likes domestic traveling, and she's been to a few places, and every time when I saw her pictures on Instagram, my heart is like, wow, I'm breathless, because it's so amazing. And you don't even think, like when you grow up in a big city like this, you don't even think that outside of the city there is so much stuff going on, and it's like really still in your country, because Russia is, like, you know, to fly to Kamchatka from Moscow, you need 9 hours. You're gonna cross 5 time zones or something like this. So it's like really, really big. And I took a few images from two very nice Instagram profiles, Russia Discovery and Russian Explorers. So if you want, please check them out. They have everything written in Russian, but you can translate, and it's really, you know, pictures are magnificent. So our first two stops will be one in Perm and the area around Perm, and another one in the south of Russia in Donbass. And the nature is breathtaking there. It's really just amazing. One of my friends, she comes from Perm as well, and she was also saying that in winter it can get really cold, like minus 40 degrees Celsius, but they're used to living in these conditions. All the trees can really get completely frosted, and altogether it looks so. It looks simply breathtaking. Donbass is already like on the border, and it's really in south of Russia, but it's a mountain area. It's amazing. I hope you can see on this screenshot with the map where it is. So it's not that far away from Moscow. I think you need to fly for 2 or 3 hours to get there, which is not that bad. Then my personal must-see and really like something that I want to visit is Lake Baikal. It's I think world's biggest lake reservoir with drinkable water. And in winter it freezes completely and you can walk around and actually look through all this, like, you know, you look really like down there because the water is so transparent. I'm pretty sure that in summer it's amazing as well because it's surrounded by forests and in general, yeah, definitely a place to see before you die. And yeah, last but not least, it's Kamchatka. It's actually like, I always have to do like west-east, where is the west-east? So yeah, it's really like eastern part of Russia, really, really far away. And it's a functioning volcano and the views are there, basically you're like on Mars. The landscape is amazing. You can actually climb the volcano itself. You can take the helicopter tours there. And yeah, as I mentioned, it's like 9-hour flight from Moscow, but I think it totally worth it. I actually was planning to do it once, but then I had only 1 week and I realized that with the time difference, I'm going to lose 2 days. So it didn't make sense back then, but I definitely want to go there and you can see the bears there and the nature is amazing. So it's really different world there. It's breathtaking. Yeah.
How are the travel conditions in Russia? So is it easy to travel around?
Well, so we have a few local airlines. I think everyone knows Aeroflot, for example. They're flying domestic as well, and they're very good. We also have a few other like air companies. I think they're all fine. Obviously, you can travel with the train, for example, or with the car. I know that the roads are not that well, especially a bit further east. You can't really like get between the cities that well. I mean, I think you can, but it's going to be a little bit like challenging for your car. And yeah, you can always take the train. Depends how much money you have. You can pay for like first class ticket and then it's going to be all good. Or you can pay like a really like Platzkart, it's called. It's basically like a wagon where you don't have any doors and you sleep all together in one room. It's a weird one. I was traveling like this to summer camps to Crimea when I was a child. It's an experience. Let's put it that way. It's especially when you have to be in this train for 24 hours. You won't with people around you because there is no other way to do that because someone's like, you know, feet are in your face when you try to get to the bathroom. So it's like, yeah, it's something interesting. So I would I think getting around in Russia is fine via planes because they're flying everywhere. They have many airports right now. And yeah, just the domestic tourist industry is actually improving right now. So you can always get from a city with some kind of like a tour or like some kind of a bus, wherever you want. So it's all doable. I think it might be way more exotic somewhere in Asia, and in Russia it's all, you know, definitely affordable and possible.
And most people speak English, so it's not a problem to communicate with the locals.
Yeah, that's the thing. I don't know. I mean, in Moscow, people definitely speak English now. So young people, for sure. In the regions, I don't know what the case there. I heard it that it's not that great. But the thing about Russian people, like we have, I think there is like a stereotype that we're very grumpy. We don't smile, you know, like when you see us, we're going to be like, but actually they're very honest and they want to help you, even if they don't speak the language. They just want to be there to help you. And when my partner started in Moscow and a few of his co-students, they were actually traveling a little bit around and they were telling stories that there was like a guy, he didn't speak a word of English, but he wanted to help us so much. And he took us to his home and he gave us like, I don't know, vodka and some food. And we even have a saying that for the guests, you can take off your last shirt, like in Russian. And it's really, we're very, the hospitality of Russian people, it's crazy. Sometimes they're like really willing to welcome you in their home and help. And especially in regions, I think that's the case. Although people live really poorly there. You don't have any money for like food or some electricity or whatever. But like for the guests, especially if they see a foreign guest, most likely they're going to be very like, you know, welcoming and yeah, honest, trying to like, you know, help you around.
Yeah, that is also what Ben told us last week. He made a hitchhiking tour from Iran to Germany and he said the people, especially in the region, were so helpful in Iran, and there was one guy who helped him to get to the border on time. And yeah, he said, you never have the idea that the people are so nice there, but as you said, they would give the last shirt for you.
Yeah, I think that's part of, you know, I think the mentality is a little bit similar in a way. Like, I wouldn't say that on many points, but in some ways, especially in relation to, like, you know, to your close ones or to the people who you just meet, you kind of want to help, especially if it's a foreigner. I don't know why, but for some reason, we are kinder to foreigners than we are sometimes to ourselves. That's a really weird feeling, but yeah, I have a feeling that it's really like this, that sometimes to each other we can be a bit more meaner or like a bit more demanding. Yeah.
But do you have any experience how it is to travel as a woman alone?
Well, I went to a few places, like around Moscow mostly, and it was all fine. I mean, like at this point, you don't really like. I went with my best friend to Suzdal, for example. It's just a few hours away from Moscow, very small village, very pretty. And we didn't experience any like difficulties or like any, you know, tension, or didn't feel that we're in danger. I mean, it's still pretty touristy, but I wouldn't go to some further regions like Dagestan or something like this, where they're like, you know, have Muslim religion, so it might be a little bit more tense there. But I think in like places like Kamchatka or Baikal, you can definitely travel and feel completely safe. I mean, keeping, you know, the general rules of staying safe, you know, not going anywhere late at night, or like, you know, flashing your iPhone everywhere or something like this, but then it should be fine.
Perfect. So do you have another slide?
Yes, actually, Nadine, that's one for you. I mean, for everyone, but since you're not the only one who is muted, you'll have to practice your Russian skills with me.
Oh my God. So that's hard for me.
Yeah, first of all, let's set things straight about Nazdarovye. I don't know how many people are here right now, but it's very important. We do not say Nazdarovye. Sorry?
27 we are.
Okay, I have a power to change 27 people's life right now. Okay, Russian people do not say Nazdarovye. You say Nazdarovye only as a reply to thank you. So for example, imagine you're sitting somewhere and someone brings you like a huge bowl of soup, like Russian soup borscht. They put it in front of you and you say thank you. And the person who brought you the soup might say Nazdarovye, like enjoy it. It's like for your health, literally translated like this. But we don't do it while drinking. It's like really weird. And yeah, another thing that if you ask someone for a cigarette out on the street, mom, if you're watching, never did it, never done, not going to do that. But if you ask someone for a cigarette on the street and they're going to give it to you, and going to say thank you, and they're going to reply Nazdarovye, and it's going to be like, you know, a bit sarcastic, like, haha, this is for your health. But it's basically like, you know, like, please in a way, and definitely not in the context of drinking. And I also, I worked in the esports industry for over a year, and thanks to Russian Counter-Strike players, I experienced a few of rough conversations with people who started saying really mean things to me in Russian out of nowhere. Like, you probably heard about Rashbi and whatever goes after that. So people know really bad Russian words, and they're happy to share that with you, although they can't say anything basic. So I decided to use this opportunity to teach you a little bit, a few of ridiculous Russian words that you might never use, but still. So first, if you're ever on a Russian wedding, you have to yell Gorko, preferably every 5 to 10 minutes, and then the newlyweds have to kiss. And the Gorko translates like bitter. And the story behind it, that back in the day when they were drinking vodka on the weddings, vodka was so bitter, but the kiss of newlyweds was so sweet that every time when they were about to take a shot of vodka, they had to scream Gorka. So the newlyweds kiss, and then you drink vodka, and then it's not that bad. So if you drink with Russian, you rather say Gorka than Nazdarovye. That's going to make way more sense to us, to be honest. Nadine, you have to repeat now.
Is it Gorka?
Gorka.
But you're saying an A at the end, right?
No, here Gorko.
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 Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Next one is
Keen or is more fluent in Russian, because I have a really bad. When I see the next ones, basavibo?
Spasibo. That's thank you.
Oh yes, spasibo. Yeah, true.
Yes, spasibo is thank you. Please use this one. That's a nice one. Then my favorite one, I think, in Russian, because everyone, when someone asks me how to say hello, I mean, we have a shorter version, but this is like a more official one, and I love it because it's, even for me, it's very difficult to pronounce. It's Здравствуйте. Okay.
No. I lost my tongue somewhere in the on the way. So I
come on, you can do it. Здравствуйте.
Здравствуйте. I have no idea.
Almost.
almost, yeah.
We're going to practice at WeWork.
Yeah, that's my challenge. You opened the Russian class for me.
Yes, especially with this Здравствуйте word. It even like hurts my tongue when I say it, honestly. What kind of word is that? We have a shorter version, which is Привет, which is a bit better, I think.
Бабушка.
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 No, on the first, the stress is on Бабушка. Yeah, on the first one.
Бабушка.
Yeah, it's. I think everyone knows that. Even ASAP Rocky had a song, Babushka Boy, recently. It's, yeah, it's my favorite word because I love my babushka. And in general, Russian babushkas are very, very strong, and they make the best food and the best borscht. So yeah, like definitely useful word. And you can actually even address, like, you know, an older lady on the street. Well, okay, like the lady that is 60 plus, you can address her like, hey, babushka, then it's going to be okay. Don't do it with young people, please.
And we word, your favorite part, because you have a lovely cat at home, right?
Yeah, I actually have two. And this is the word, how I call my partner, how I call my colleagues, how I call my cats, my best friend. I call everyone that. That's kotik.
Kotik.
Yes, it's basically like
cute. So it's like my dear, like sweetheart or something like that.
It's like what, sorry?
Something like sweetheart, my dear, or
yes, yes. Yes, it's something like sweetheart, but yeah, cat related.
Kotik?
Yes, you're saying that perfectly, you're nailing it.
Yeah, so that's my favorite word from now on.
Yeah. Now you can say Здравствуй, котик, to wrap it up, like, hello, cat.
After a glass of wine, we will come back to that.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you so much, because that's it, right? No?
Yeah, that's it. That's it. I'm going to stop sharing.
I love it that you showed us so many parts of Russia, and I'm pretty sure a lot of us want to travel now to your home country, but I also get that there are really some problems the world has, yeah, also to see in Russia, which are not going well right now. So I hope that also other countries will push a little bit, yeah, I don't know, Putin. In this case, you can just say it's Putin, because he seems to be the leader of the country, and it's a single leader. And do you have any questions? Someone wants to say something? No? Otherwise, I just want to ask you to have a last picture, maybe, with all of us. So if you, wait one second. I need to take two. Yeah. One second again. Yeah. Thank you so much for watching and being part of this amazing community. And I really, really hope you enjoyed our little 1 hour travel journey. Next week, we have Yuki here. Maybe you can just say something that we know who you are. Otherwise, yeah, there she is. Hi.
I'm Yuki, and I'm also living in Cologne, like Nadine. I'm originally from Japan, and with my non-Japanese boyfriend, I had a trip to Japan, and he's a photographer, so he will show some nice pictures of Japan, and we will talk about our trip next week about Japan.
Yeah, so everyone who wants to travel with us again, we will see you next week. Check out all our events, the global events on Friday, and there are lots of field trips going on. So I think now it's the best part to connect with everyone. And yeah, I wish you a nice day, afternoon, evening, good night. And I will join the Denver chapter in a few hours and to support a little bit Dave. So it's a long night for me. And I would say kisses, küsse, bisous, and baccio, and see you. Good night.
Bye.
Bye.